It's your drive home on Ruscin and Zach, powered by Mr. Sparky.
Need a licensed electrician to service your home? Give us a jingle, or just use this one.
You don't have to put up with any malarkey. Call 888-8-SPARKY.
For local pros, call Mr. Sparky.
Man, we're delighted to have with us once again Tim Brando from Fox Sports here on Ruscin and Zach. Timmy B, good afternoon, sir. How you doing?
Great to be with both of you guys. How are you?
And we are living doing great. Well, I mean, people in Arkansas are feeling pretty good right now, as you can imagine. Tim, 4-0, beating Texas A&M in the huge national TV CBS game on Saturday afternoon. From watching it from the outside, what do you make of this resurrection of Razorback football under Sam Pittman?
Honestly, I have to come back and look at games that I DVR, which I did this one, and I did catch a good bit of it, not all of it, but a good bit of it. Really, I couldn't be happier for your fan base. You know, I recall being a part of and calling on not just CBS, but Jefferson Pilot even, some of the biggest wins that Arkansas ever had, their first win ever against Alabama. The Lunny to J.J. Metters catch when Danny was just getting started, Danny Ford, when they secured a division championship with Danny beating Mississippi State in Little Rock. And, it, you know, this was a long drought. I mean, a long, perilous drought for the Arkansans. You know, they live and die in a way that so many other programs don't with their team, because you have no other real programs there, no NFL, no NBA, and this is your baby, you know. And as the state school, it just I hate to use the SEC moniker, but the Razorbacks in Arkansas, it really does just mean more. I mean, everyone's on the edge of their chairs in that state watching an Arkansas game. So whether it be basketball or football, I've certainly had my fair share of moments for Arkansas fans that I've been able to call. And really, since the Petrino debacle, it's been a long, long wait. And congratulations to all of you. And the job that Sam Pittman's done is just incredible. I mean, right now, he's my coach of the year. And it's really between Sam and the Lane Train at Ole Miss. Those two programs have bolstered the Western Division now into a place where you really just can't find a W. You know, you can't look at your schedule and see a check mark automatically there. You know, even Mississippi State has its moments. You know, they scared LSU late, I think, the other day. So congratulations to you know, the school and its fan base, because I know you waited a long time. And as big as the Texas win was, and I think it probably was bigger from a program standpoint because of the rich history between the two programs in the old Southwest Conference and the sort of redheaded stepchild that Arkansas always was in that league, and the way Texas fans made them feel, that probably was the bigger game nationally. But within this conference, in the modern era of the SEC, this was a game that you just needed to get off the schneid, and you did. And the fact that Jefferson was forced to leave and then was replaced, and Arns became – you know, a lot of good things happened. And everyone seemed to know their roles. And that's a credit to your coaching staff. It really is.
We were talking just a little while ago about – you know, it's 14 games, and all of a sudden they're in the top 10 from the depths that they came from. And we're trying to come up with, and you've got much better perspective on this, teams that have sort of just risen from the ashes and shot into the top 10. The only thing I can think of is Oklahoma when Bob Stoops came in 99 and then won the title in 2000. It doesn't happen that often.
No, it doesn't. Actually, I think in the modern era, the BCS era, LSU started at, I think they were at the worst possible position to start before they won the national championship in 2003. I want to say they were 13th in the preseason poll. Now, again, we're in the college football playoff era now, and maybe some other teams that were ranked worse than that made significant moves. But no, I don't. You know, look, if Arkansas can keep this going, and that's a big if with who you have to navigate in the SEC West to get there. I really thought you guys were going to be more ecstatic about where you were in Timmy B's top 10 today than you were the AP.
That was my next. Okay. That was going to be my next. That's going to be my next question. You hit you a little higher up.
I got you at 8. You know, I got you. I actually moved Ole Miss into the 10th position this week, and they had a week off. But I just think this is one of those years, fellas, where we have this perfect confluence of post-COVID, additional years given. So the super senior factor is coming into play, which definitely helps a lot of teams. And Arkansas is part of that, without question. But also we have a lot of schools that had great quarterbacks. They didn't come back to college. They left. And that's what's happened to Clemson. To some extent, that's what's happened to Ohio State, although most of their problems are on defense, not offense. But, you know, they lost Justin Fields, who's a big-time player, and Clemson lost Lawrence, and they have not been adequately replaced. So we have, I think, a lot more balance in college football this year, and even the teams that are still there, like Georgia and like Alabama, I'll put them in that number. Okay, I will. I'm not sure if Alabama's one, and I'm really not sure that Georgia's two. And the reason is I'm not sure that Bryce Young or JT Daniels are all that yet. Now, he had a great game against Miami, but Miami's awful. We've now seen that since the game was played. Georgia is doing it with defense, certainly not with their offense. And when Daniels has played in big games, and I'll go back to last year's Peach Bowl, Cincinnati should have won that game, and Georgia did not do much offensively in that game. So against good defenses, I'm not sold on Daniels as being all that, even for Georgia. And those teams are ranked 1 and 2. So I think that this is as balanced as we've ever seen it, and it actually has been this way for a long time. It's just nobody wanted to talk about it in the media because it was the same teams all the times. The brands were winning out because of this godforsaken system we have in play. We've had, 7 years of the playoff era, and we've only had 11 teams make the playoff. So people have become just accustomed to it being that same 4 or 5 team core group. And right now, all of them, I mean, Oklahoma looks to be a fraud right now. They could have easily lost last week. I mean, who else besides Alabama? And as I said, I see a few chinks in their armor, too. I think they're not right now where Nick Saban wants them to be. So I think all bets are off, and it's going to be a whale of a season to see who can shoehorn themselves into the top four spots.
We're talking with Tim Brando from Fox Sports here on Ruskin and Zach. Do you recall, Zach and I were talking before the show, maybe 2007, a season like this where it's just so, you know, you've got to, we can't really figure out right now who the four are going to be. We may not be able to figure out November.
No, that's a great number to pick out because, and what happened that year? Ultimately, LSU won it, and they won it because of their brand and where they were, you know, how they started their season. They lost 2 triple overtime games, 1 to Kentucky midseason and 1 to Arkansas in their last game. They walked off the field Thanksgiving weekend thinking that they were done. Okay. They fell all the way to number 7. And then you had the amazing situation where it appeared that Les Miles was going to go to Michigan at one point. It was being reported that he'd go there. They managed to beat Tennessee, and again they're in a situation where they've lost their quarterback. Okay, couldn't play in that game. Glenn Dorsey was their best tackle, and he was injured. And they managed to win the game, and then all these crazy things happened, including LeSean McCoy of Pitt having this unbelievable game. And they beat West Virginia with Pat Smith and that incredible talent that Rich Rodriguez had, which enabled LSU to move all the way from number 7 to number 2. Think about that. A lot of crazy things had to happen for that to occur, and you had your first 2-loss national champion that season. We could see something that crazy, but I think in a lot of ways, fellas, especially when it comes to this the playoff system that we have, we don't have any checks and balances on the opinions of this committee. So in a lot of ways, it's still they're still going to be impacted by brand names and teams that, to them, just look better when they're warming up than other teams. How else would you know? So I'm fearful for teams that are upstart teams, but at the same time, I think the door is open for, like, for instance, a club like Cincinnati. Cincinnati, who I did not rank this weekend because they didn't play last weekend, and the weekend before that, I thought they struggled against Indiana, probably should have lost that game, got a good call, which helped them come back and win it. But if Cincinnati beats Notre Dame after what Notre Dame just did to Wisconsin, they're going to shoot right back up there. And out of the group of five, you got road wins against Indiana and Notre Dame. They're going to get a lot of love. I mean, Cincinnati is going to get a lot of love. So it is a crazy, crazy season.
We asked this question last week, and I'll ask it to you. I mean, the top four is Alabama, Georgia, Oregon, Penn State. Which of those teams is most likely to not make it, and who is most likely to replace them in the top 10?
I don't see Oregon making it. They played very poorly against one of the worst teams in the Pac-12. They almost gave the game away to Arizona. I don't know how many people stayed up late enough to watch it, but as good as Oregon looked in the game that they won at Ohio State, what have we since learned about Ohio State? I mean, I watched Tulsa go in there and put over 500 yards of offense against them. Okay, so I think the Oregon win, while impressive at the time, I don't see them with the consistency on both sides of the ball to pull it off. So that's one team right away that I don't believe will be there at the end. Because plus there are other teams in that league, in the Pac-12, that are pretty competitive. And crazy things happen out there. They always do. A lot of competitive balance, but I don't see any dominant teams. Oregon just, you know, has the brand, and they played big early with that huge win, an impactful win on the road against Ohio State. I really believe that Georgia is not as good as labeled, because I just don't think their offense is that dynamic in big games. Then Arkansas could expose that. I don't know if you heard what Kirby Smart had to say, but it sounds as if he's a little fearful that he's got a berries and cream crowd for an early game, which I think if I'm Arkansas, if I'm the players and the coaching staff at Arkansas, I am licking my chops. I mean, I would put them on upset alert right now. I would. Your mojo is really solid. And look, I mean, the Lane Train, if you were to pick any team out there to beat Alabama, from a matchup standpoint, the team that I would pick first is Ole Miss. They know how to do it. Lane is sort of in Saban's head. He's had the chance with an awful defense that was ranked 134th out of 136. All he has to do is his defense to be average and know that his club can, you know, probably have to score 50 to beat him. You know, Alabama's had to score 45 and more to beat a lot of teams with dynamic offenses. Ole Miss's offense is dynamic. I think Arkansas's offense is also big play and explosive, but its defense is just out of sight right now. And there's no denying in my mind that we could be seeing a changing of the guard. What if Arkansas and Ole Miss are actually all that, and Georgia and Alabama are overrated? I mean, you can make a case that that's already true. We don't know, but you can make a case that it's already true.
There'd be a lot of drunk people on Dixon Street. I can guarantee you that. Hey, I want to ask you, you've got the FS1 game Friday night, Iowa at Maryland. You saw them last week. To me, in the top 10, they're the team that kind of sticks out that has, to me, has the most questions surrounding them.
Well, you say that because they don't have a sexy offense.
No, not
at
all.
When you rank, I mean, when you look at Iowa, you know, you don't see that much explosive or dynamic offensive play out of them. But here's what they do have. They have a defense that's, I think, the best in the country this side of Georgia's. And because you don't see them as often, you don't recognize that. You look at the numbers. Spencer Petras is he's not a QBR rating guru, and they don't have guys that you can automatically think are going to dial up big plays. But here's what Iowa does. They beat you with special teams, and they beat you with defense. a suffocating defense that's number four in the country in scoring defense, is unbelievable against the run. And you say, well, who have they beaten? Well, they took care of Indiana, and Indiana was highly thought of going into the season. And they beat Iowa State. I believe Iowa State was preseason top 10. And they beat them handily in the Cy-Hawk game. But they scored with their defense. So in a lot of ways, they're one of the most consistent teams out there that's ranked in the top 10. Penn State is probably more dynamic from an offensive standpoint, but I think Iowa is more consistent. Now it'll be interesting to see when they go up against Coach Locksley and Tagovailoa, the brother of Tua, obviously the quarterback for Maryland. He's a big time arm, and they make big plays to win games. It will be a transition for them coming off a team that likes to run it and goes with a lot of RPOs like Colorado State. And I've heard a lot of people say, yeah, you know, they beat Colorado State, who barely beat Vanderbilt. Well, who lost to Vanderbilt, I should say. Teams this time of year, guys, are evolving, okay? And you can look like hell one week and come back and play a great game the next. It's just amazing how that works. You know, the middle tier of college football is just, you know, throw up a four-sided coin. We just don't know what's going to happen. I would think probably as you look at the top 10, they would be the one that you would easily say, gee, you know, I don't know that they could win in a shootout. Well, okay, what if there aren't any shootouts? Their defense doesn't seem to allow big plays, and they really don't. I mean, Iowa defensively just shuts people down. So I hear the question and I understand it, but I'm here to tell you there's more to this team than maybe meets the eye. They know and love and are very comfortable winning ugly. And we live in a world now where people just, they want to be, you know, wowed. And college football fans want to be wowed, and Iowa is not a wow team.
Talking with Tim Brando from Fox Sports here on Ruscin and Sack. This kind of dovetails into my next question for you, Tim, which is, you know, Arkansas didn't make a ton of headlines when they hired Sam Pittman as the head coach, but it seems like they got that really right. And yet so many high-profile schools seem to get the hire wrong. Why do you think that is?
Because they're all trying to win the press conference. We live in a world, my friend Spencer Tillman loves to say it, and it's true. We live in a world of images and impressions. And athletic directors and the people around them that are part of search committees, they want to win press conferences, which does not always translate to winning football games. And I got to be honest with you. Sam Pittman was a line coach, offensive line coach. And again, you go back to not extraordinarily popular, not extraordinarily charismatic necessarily with the media. Although I think when you've seen him evolve as the head coach at Arkansas, he seemingly has really become an outstanding fit. And is a kind of a no-nonsense, engaging coach. The fans there and the media there seem to be extremely high on him, and I can see why. But again, from the outside looking in, the hiring of an O-line coach from Georgia, just it was like, huh, okay, that's what you're doing. And meanwhile, of course, you had Lane going to Ole Miss. You had the hiring of the mad scientist to Mississippi State. Everyone's doing all these dynamic things, and Arkansas, to their credit, just said, you know what, we're going to get somebody that we believe will be a quality fit at our place. And it was a hell of a hire. It really was. And paying huge dividends. I did not see this coming. I really didn't. I've known Coach for a while, but I've not spent a lot of time with him because he was, even when I was calling games in the SEC, he wasn't a coordinator. You know, and so generally speaking, the guys I'm going to talk to when prepping for a game are either going to be the head coaches or the OCs or the DCs, and I never had a chance to visit with him. But boy, have I been impressed. And again, I think it speaks volumes about the decision-making when most programs are making coaching changes, coaching hires. They're in a panic. And sometimes the outcomes of the hirings themselves are a direct result of that panic. It appeared this time that Arkansas looked at itself in the mirror and said, look, we've gotten away from who we are. and what we are. And it all starts in a line of scrimmage league and at the line of scrimmage. And that doesn't mean that you can't have a dynamic offense. Clearly, Arkansas does. You know, you're a vertical passing, spread it out, run the football off the formations, and get vertical with your passing game team. You know, O-line coaches don't have to be 3 yards in a cloud of dust or move into an I formation on fourth down and get outnumbered trying to make a first down. Many of them can be just great CEOs, and he has certainly been that, no question about it. I'm very impressed, not just with what he did there, but what you did on the defensive side with Barry Odom. My God, I mean, that one of the best moves ever. All right, and that just goes back to lineage, understanding the game, and knowing the people that can really coach up certain sides of the ball. Just a tremendous move, and one that a lot of head coaches, frankly, fellas, would not make. They'd be intimidated by having a guy like that on their staffs. You know, a lot of times head coaches, especially young ones, they don't want to have someone in a place like a D coordinator where they feel like, you know what, if they wanted to get rid of me, they could make him an interim real quick. You know what I mean?
Yep.
That kind of psychoanalysis could be done on a lot of head coaches because of their egos. And again, I go back to he was the right man at the right time and mature enough to step right in to handle, you know, what comes with being a head football coach.
Yeah. All right, Tim, we appreciate the time as always. Thank you so much.
Great talking to you guys. Anytime.
Tim Brando, Fox Sports, with us here on Ruskin and Zach on your drive home.
All day.
Powered by Mr. Sparky.
All day.
I know. And it's just, you know, here's the fun thing for me right now is that there's still so many things we don't know about this football season. Nationally. Like, we don't know. We don't know what the top four is. I mean, people are writing things for the last month about the top four. We don't know. I mean, who thought Clemson would be terrible? Like, nobody had that. Oh, you did?
No,
okay.
No,
well,
really.
Well, good for you. Yeah,
no,
there
no,
you go.
No, definitely not.
So, I mean, it's just, this is one of those years.
Did.
Yeah, he had him out.
Yeah, he had North Carolina in, though.
Oh, well, that's a. A lot of the prediction people from the summertime are going to take a beating with this football
who
season.
Had it's Wake been, Forest winning the ACC?
Yeah, that's where we are. That's where we are, going to the Peach Bowl, perhaps. All right, Ruskin and Zach here. Phil and.